generally found in the United States, Europe, and parts of Asia. Most places with brush and dense vegetation have reported most cases of tularemia. People who camp, hunt, or dwell in these areas are more prone to tularemia. Australia is the only place in the Southern Hemisphere where cases of tularemia have been documented. In this first photo, this is a photo of the Francis Solitarius bacterium. This second photo depicts where in the world tularemia is most prevalent. In the Northern Hemisphere, North America, the continents of North America, Europe, and Asia are most commonly recognized to have the most cases of tularemia. In the Southern Hemisphere, the only continent which has documented tularemia is Australia. This orange dot in the center indicates that cases of tularemia have been reported. Hashiro Okada was a Japanese physician who described the earliest forms of tularemia. He concluded from his research that tularemia mainly affected people who hunted or ate rabbits. In 1912, researchers in Tulare County, California, observed a disease which plagued squirrels. The researchers isolated the bacteria which caused the disease and named it Bacterium tularensis, after the county in which it was found. In 1914, the first definite case of tularemia in a human was reported in Cincinnati, Ohio. Dr. Edward Francis made many contributions to the research of Bacterium tularensis. Eventually, the Bacterium tularensis was renamed Francis Solitarensis after Dr. Francis as a token of gratitude for his discoveries. In the 1940s, tularemia was used as a weapon of bioterrorism by the Soviet Union. During World War II, the Soviet Union intentionally released an airborne strain of tularemia in Eastern Europe. This caused many civilian casualties. The United States tested the F. tularensis bacteria as a biological warfare agent on volunteers. Volunteers would inhale the Francis tularensis bacteria, and their symptoms would be studied. If a mass attack using the Francis tularensis bacteria was launched in a metropolitan area of 5 million, 250 million people would be infected, which is about 5% of the population, and 19,000 people would die, which is about 0.38% of the population. Though those numbers sound insignificant, tularemia is very serious and can cause fatalities. There are two main subspecies of tularemia. They are F. tularensis, subspecies tularensis, or otherwise known as Jolson type A, and the other species is F. tularensis, subspecies Puertia, or otherwise known as Jolson type B. Throughout this presentation, I'll refer to both of them as type A and type B, respectively. Type A is mainly found in the United States, while type B is mainly found in parts of Eurasia. In type A, it mainly is highly pathogenic in animals and humans, while type B is less pathogenic. A vector is an insect or another organism that transmits a pathogenic fungus, virus, bacterium, etc. Vectors of tularemia are ticks, deer flies, and mosquitoes. In the United States, tularemia is prevalent in areas where camping, hunting, and fishing are popular. These areas tend to have more vegetation, and oropharyngeal, and lindor. Also, lindor is the most common form of tularemia. It makes up about 75% of all cases. It is caused by ticks, butterflies, and mosquitoes. High fever, chills, headaches, extreme fatigue, and the formation of skin ulcers are all symptoms of this form. In this photo, skin ulcers are found on this woman's neck, indicating ulceroglandular tularemia. Typhoidal is the second most common form of tularemia. It is speculated to be caused by ingestion of infected food. It is unclear what exactly it is caused by, but it causes fever, exhaustion, weight loss, lung problems, and sometimes pneumonia as well. This photo depicts the lungs of an infected patient infected by typhoidal tularemia. Pneumonic tularemia is caused through the inhalation of Francisella tularensis bacteria. Chest pain, dry cough, and respiratory issues are all symptoms of this form. Generally, in this form, the bacteria becomes airborne, and this causes people to be able to inhale it. The x-ray here depicts a person with pneumonic tularemia. These arrows right here show the abnormalities that pneumonic tularemia gives. Oculoglandular tularemia occurs when the Francisella tularensis bacteria makes contact with the eye. Redness and discomfort are all symptoms. This is a photo of a human eye afflicted by oculoglandular tularemia. Oropharyngeal tularemia is caused by consuming undercooked meat from a creature, most commonly rabbit, infected with tularemia. Symptoms of oropharyngeal tularemia include fever, sore throat or pharyngitis, mouth ulcers, vomiting, and diarrhea. Glandular tularemia is very similar to ulceroglandular tularemia, except the formation of skin ulcers does not occur in this case. It is caused by ticks, deer flies, mosquitoes, just like in ulceroglandular tularemia. The symptoms of are high fever, chills, swollen glands, headaches, and extreme fatigue. And these are both the same in both of the forms. To diagnose tularemia, normally a blood or sputum test is performed. Sputum is most commonly known as phlegm. A blood or sputum sample is taken from the patient and is cultured to encourage the growth of bacteria. The bacteria is later analyzed, and it is determined whether the patient has tularemia or not. For typhoidal and pneumonic tularemia, a chest x-ray is used to look for signs of these forms. Treatments. Treatments for tularemia include antibiotics like streptomycin, or its alternative, which is called gentamicin, and fluoroquinolones. Currently, tularemia vaccines and other forms of immunization are being developed, but a live vaccine strain will be on the market in a decade. To prevent tularemia, repellents containing DEET, which is a toxin that kills insects, should be worn on the skin in these vegetaceous areas. Clothing should be treated with a repellent to also prevent insect bites. After handling animal carcasses, washing your hands properly with soap and warm water is best to ensure that the Francisella tularensis bacteria is properly removed. Drinking water should be from a reliable source in order to prevent any chance of contamination. Although tularemia is a relatively rare disease, it can be serious and cause fatalities. Its vectors are ticks, mosquitoes, and deer flies. The bacteria can enter through the skin, mucous membrane, which lines the inside of the body. And examples of the mucous membrane are inside the mouth and nasal passages. Ingestion or inhalation are also ways the bacteria can enter the body. The most common form of tularemia is also ulceroglandular, which is caused by infected ticks, mosquitoes, or deer flies. Skin ulcers are formed as a result of this. Diagnosis of tularemia is generally a blood or sputum test. Streptomycin is the most recommended antibiotic treatment by experts and researchers. precautions, though they may seem tedious, is easier than dealing with the symptoms of tularemia. Future applications include research on live vaccine strains to perhaps prevent tularemia in the form of a vaccine. I'd like to acknowledge my parents, my little sister Maya, my extended family, all my friends, Ms. Lau, Ms. Catherine, Ms. Winstead, Mr. Marriott, Mr. Robinson, Dr. Nib, Dr. Williams, all my teachers at PSTQ, the SMU staff, and anyone else I've forgotten. These are my sources. Thank you for listening to my presentation. Are there any questions?
With regards to tularemia, or is it mostly just like if